Tonight, before I begin speaking to you, I'd like to ask you if you would just think of a person in our church or in your family, in your Sunday school class, in your circle of friends who may be praying and asking God to heal them of cancer, of sickness, of a mental, emotional disorder. You've prayed, you've thought you've come through it, you thought the last surgery would suffice, you thought that if you waited a whole year, that it would, things would change. And your trial, your test, it keeps on going. Tonight, I'm preaching on healing, so I'd like you to keep that person's name and their face in your mind and join me here at the altar and just bring that person before the Lord and take that person to the Lord. Let's all stand together. And if you're praying that God would heal you or someone in your family, someone close to you, someone in your church, you know them, maybe you want to go to them right now and come to the altar with them and ask God to do a wonderful thing in his timing and heal them and bring an end to their pain, to their suffering, through their time of trial. Lord Jesus, whether we're standing in a pew or kneeling here at the altar, we praise you and we sing a song of praise in the midst of our trials and storms. Those storms point us to an end. Not all storms will last, and certainly the storm of this life with sin and the suffering of it will all for each of us come to a closure. And then there's eternity. Until then, Lord, we live in the earthly realm, and as Paul said, he prayed that his thorn in the flesh would be removed, and three times at three different intervals of his life, God, you taught Paul that your grace was sufficient for him in the midst of his suffering and overcoming. And yet he went on to say, Lord, that he has learned in all things and in all manner to be content in the state that he is in, whether he was talking about singleness and celibacy or whether he was talking about suffering through his pain and thorn in his flesh. There's much, Lord, we do not understand about physical, emotional, mental, earthly suffering, but we know we must endure. So each of us, Lord, bring a person or persons to you at this altar. Lord Jesus, I lift up to you my own daughter. And I pray that her suffering through arthritis would go into remission, be medically, medicinally, or spiritually healed. And I'm also thankful, Lord, because I know the character that you've built in Hannah through these years of suffering and overcoming crisis, it's made her into the lady that she is and the lady that my mother was. And I lift up to you my good friend and co-worker in the faith, Teresa. And I pray, Lord, that you would touch her vocal cords and that your spirit would heal her. And Lord, if not through the power of a miracle where we could see it and sense it, Lord, through medicine and doctors, I pray that I know that Teresa wants her voice to be an instrument of praise to you, like Ray playing the tuba, or Reese playing the trombone, or one of our ladies playing the sax. It's an instrument, our vocal cords, and we want them to praise you. So Lord, answer the praise request of Miss Teresa. Bless her with her voice again. And then Lord, I recognize that each of us have a person or persons that we're lifting before your throne right now. And every single person at this altar and standing at their seat, we each have a mind to know a person, a man or a woman, a boy or a girl that we're praying for. And we recognize, Lord, that faith heals. But we also recognize, Lord, that you are the healer. So heal our hearts, Lord. May we praise you in season and out of season. May there be in the storms and in the cell a song of praise from our lips, praising you, the God of all gods, the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, for who you are, for you have healed us, and we are being healed. Thank you, Lord, for your healing presence in our lives. Now, Lord, may we leave this altar expecting to receive answers to our prayers, knowing that you definitively answer the prayers of a saint who comes to you in praise in your name and for your will to be accomplished. In Jesus' holy name, and all God's children said, amen. While they're going to their seats, listen, I know that I preached last Sunday morning about there is hope. Hope is the assurance that which God has promised he will bring to pass. The assurance that which God has promised he will bring to pass. This morning I preached on not only is there hope, but there's help. His name is Jesus. And when Jesus departed, his disciples were so worried, saying, we can't do this without you. And he's like, oh, you'll do greater things than I have done, because I'm going to send the Comforter, the Helper, and he's going to guide you in all ways. He's going to be a master teacher to you. So he is our help, and he covers our sin with his covering, his atonement. And tonight, as there is healing, God does heal us. Just because we're Baptist doesn't mean we don't believe that God heals. In fact, we of all denominations and all people should believe in healing. Not the way you see on television, not the way you would see in some healing services that focus on the preacher or the penny spent to have your seed sown. Not at all. God, through the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, healed some people as a result of their parents' or friends' faith, not the person. Well, I'll address that in a few moments, but it doesn't take faith for a person to be healed. There are many instances in the New Testament where all people were healed that were in attendance. And there were some where you had to know there had to be people of faith in attendance, and yet there was no healing. There were no great miracles done because of a lack of unbelief. Could it be that we have a lack of unbelief in our church, in our country, in the state, to where we can't? We're hindering the power of miracles and medicinal help of healing because of our lack of faith and trust in God. So there is hope. The last part of this is there is healing. You know that when the Good Samaritan, Luke chapter 10, when he not only paid for that man to be put into an inn, but he anointed him with oil and medicinally treated him, he gave him healing ointments and help. And then he took him to an inn and paid for at least 2 days of him being cared, and said, when I come back, if more is needed, I'll pay for that then. He cared about his healing, and the Lord cares about your healing. So Luke 10 verses 33 and 34. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. When he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him, and he bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And he sent him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, take care of him, and whatever more you spend when I come again, I will repay you. Turn with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. So it was, verse 40, so it was when Jesus returned that the multitude welcomed him, for they were all waiting for him. Behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was the ruler of the synagogue, a ruler. He fell down at Jesus' feet and begged him to come to his house, for he had an only daughter about 12 years of age, and she was dying. The story goes on. You know the story. As Jesus was going to Jairus' house, he was going to heal her. There was a woman with a flow of blood for 12 years. She had been to all the doctors, couldn't help her. She could not receive medical treatment that would suffice. She was still without help, without hope, and without healing. So she came to Jesus. And she thought to herself, if only I can just touch just the edge, just the trims that hangs down off the hem of his garment, I can be healed. She had that kind of, she never made notice. She worked her way through the audience, because had she even let herself be outed, a woman with a flow of blood like this touching other people would have been outed in the community, and they would have made her to feel and to say, I am unclean. I'm not even to be in a throng of people. But she came and just touched the hem of his garment. And she was healed. Jesus, recognizing power out of her, asked the question, who touched me? The disciples laughed. This is such a crazy crowd. I mean, are you serious? Who touched you? And then he explained himself. Well, all this happened and she was healed. And he outed her, called her his daughter. The only time in the New Testament Jesus makes reference to another woman in calling her part of his family. What kind of faith did she have? Not just healing, but saving faith. But then he continues on his way to Jairus' house. But one of his servants came, Jairus' servants, and said, don't get the rabbi. Don't bother the rabbi. Let him do his thing. Your daughter has died. So Jesus says to them, she sleeps. Let's keep going. He comes to the house, takes just 3 of his disciples and the mother and father into the room. People are mocking him outside because they're like, he doesn't get it. She's dead. He goes in the room, calls the girls back. He resuscitates her back to life. He didn't resurrect her. She was going to die again, and she did. But he resuscitates her, brings her back to life. She didn't have faith that raised her up. She was dead. Mom and dad, many of the friends of them, their faith, when she died, it was over. And I said to the staff this last Monday, all of us would go into the hospital and pray over any person in this room or any of your family members. But if you invited us into your hospital room and your loved one had just passed away, you would think that we're half crazy, maybe all the way crazy, and be put into a straitcoat if we started praying, Lord, raise them back up. Because we've just not seen that happen. But there he is. He's calling this girl back to life. It's an amazing thing. Both the woman who had the flow of blood for 12 years and this little girl, they were healed. So my point tonight is, if Christ can heal a little girl who's died, and Christ can heal a woman who can't get medicinal and medical, physical help, but she gets spiritual help from him, and he miraculously heals her. You know where I'm going? Why doesn't he heal me? Why didn't he heal my son, my daughter? Why doesn't he heal my friend? Why doesn't he heal the folks of Anniston, all laced with cancer throughout our community? Why does he allow bad things to happen to good people? Look with me at Luke chapter 6. We all look forward to a day when this will happen, but Luke chapter 6, verse 17, and he, Jesus, came down with them and stood on a level place with a crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon who came to hear him and to be, what? Healed of their diseases, as well as those who were tormented with unclean spirits. And they were healed. And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for power went out from him, and he healed them all. Wow, what a movement. I'd love to be a part of that. I've witnessed some healing in my day. Burley Wedge, she had cancer all through her. My dad and the staff, the deacons, prayed, and she asked them, James chapter 5, verse 13 and following, she followed scripture, and Verley came and asked my father and the deacons, the staff, to anoint her with oil. And I was just a kid. But everyone knew, you could see it, because Verley had lost so much weight. She looked the picture of death. But a week later, she came to church that next Sunday morning. And boy, did she look good. Hadn't gained any weight, but she looked a whole lot better in color. And when she went to her doctors that week, they opened her up to remove a portion, and they closed her right back up and said, Verley, we're putting you through all the scans, and we don't get this. This is a miraculous thing. You've been healed. I don't think it was my father. I don't think it was the deacons. I don't think it was anything, but God chooses to heal some. And I'd love to have it all figured out where I could say, when you're going to be healed, you're not. Get ready for this. But I want you to picture something different about this word healing. Go with me in your Bibles back to Mark chapter 6. Maybe our minds need to be readjusted to some things. Jesus did say, in this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer, I have overcome this world. Mark chapter 6, starting at verse 1. Then he went out from there, and he came to his own country, and his disciples followed him. And when the Sabbath had come, he began to teach in the synagogue. Many hearing him were astonished, saying, where did this man get these things? What wisdom is this which is given unto him, that such mighty works are performed by his hands? Is this not the carpenter? You want to make notes of this, because most Catholics, when they read this in Mark, and also it's found in Matthew, they're shocked, because they'd never have learned this in catechism or at their church. Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? So they were offended at him. See, the Catholic Church teaches that Mary remained chaste and a virgin, but she had other children. Jesus was the only immaculate conceived son of God. So he had brothers, half-brothers, and he had sisters. And they're shocked to see that. You can't put down the Catholic Church. It's not like the Baptist Church has never taught something untrue. But Catholics are shocked when they see this. There's some priests that don't even, they know the Bible, but they just skip over this. Oh, Jesus had brothers and sisters. That means Mary had to know a man and had other children. Oh, if she was a saint and never sinned, they can't put that together. But let me get back on track here. He had brothers and sisters, and people were shocked because he was human. And he came from Galilee. He came from this region. We're known for being redneck here. And he's one of us. I mean, what's his deal? Who does he think he is? Where does this power come from? Are not his sisters here with us? So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to him, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country, among his own relatives, and in his own house. Now, he could do no mighty work there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. That's, wow. There's places that God doesn't move as mightily because of a lack of faith of people. They choose to live in a state of disbelief or unbelief or questioning, being cynical or skeptical that he could and will. So where am I going with this? Who has Jesus healed? Why is it that we pray for healing and we don't receive it? Oh, my friends, you're getting that wrong. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5. Isaiah 53, verse 5. Well, look back with me at verse 4. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, afflicted. But, verse 5, he was wounded for our transgressions, our rebellion. He was bruised for our iniquities, our perverseness, our crookedness. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and say it with me, and by his stripes we are healed. Turn to the person next to you and say, I've been healed. Oh, that was horrible. Y'all don't believe it, unless there's a bunch of unsaved people here tonight. When you accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, let me tell you, in the original language there in Hebrew, you have been healed. And you weren't healed the moment that you got saved. Not at all. You were healed in eternity past. He knew who would accept him. You say, you sure about that, preacher? Sure. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. Who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. Peter didn't get it wrong because he was a redneck. He was under the power of the Holy Spirit when he or his secretary wrote this. He used the right tense that it happened in eternity past, because God, according to Romans 8:29, for whom he foreknew, those he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he, Jesus Christ, might be the firstborn among many brethren. He knew you before time began. He knew who would accept him and receive him and who would not. So based upon his foreknowledge of that, he has paid the debt for your sin. And listen to me. You are healed. I am healed. I will die unless the rapture occurs. I will die and I will taste the first death. I will taste of the physical death. But that's it. The second that I am in the ground, being covered by dirt, is the moment that I will live like I've never lived before. You say, in your physical tense? No. In my soul and spirit, I immediately go to be with him and with the Lord. But in my body, I'm going to be awakened by him, raptured by him, according to 1 Thessalonians. And in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, I will be with him. The dead in Christ shall rise first. And then we who are and remain at that time are raptured up and taken him. And so shall we ever be. The end of the story. You are healed. There is nothing of death that can take anything eternal away from you. You will live forever. Doesn't stop the pain of today. Go with me to Acts chapter 27. This is where I'll end tonight. I'm reading a lot to you, but you got to see this. How many of you watch? Gina's going to hate this. How many of you watch? Most of this will be men. On Friday nights, Gold Rush. Man, I love the show. I know how it's going to start. I know how it's going to end. The language isn't the best, but here's the treasure. They got to go through a lot of dirt to get a little gold, right? You just go through tons of dirt to just get a few specks of gold. But they measure it out per, not tonnage, per ounce for the tonnage that they go through. And Christian, listen to me. You just got to go through a lot of dirt to get through some nuggets. That's true with reading the Word of God. You're not going to stand at the Word of God and read a verse or two and become spiritually mature. You got to dig. There's treasure in there for the treasure hunter. You've got to dig, and you've never arrived at a place where you think to yourself, I have arrived. I understand this text, because the next day you'll read the same text and you'll say, how'd I miss this? That's what it is to find in the Word of God. So just remember this. You got to go through a lot to bring some good to other people. You got to be willing to let the thorn in the flesh crush you, burden you, break you to the point that you just say, Lord, I'm just so broken, I can't. But 2 Corinthians 10:13, he knows no trial, no test, no tribulation such as common to man, but God has provided and made a way of escape. He knows how much you can take, so he doesn't allow you to go beyond his breaking point. He has a reason for it. So Acts chapter 7, get ready to follow with me. And when it was decided that we should sail to Italy, we delivered Paul and some other prisoners to one named Julius, a centurion of Augustan regiment. So entering the ship of Adramyttium, we put to sea, meaning to sail along the coast of Asia. Aristarchus, a Macedonian of Thessalonica, was with us. The next day we landed at Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly, gave him liberty to go to his friends and receive care. When we have put to sea from there, we sailed under the shelter of Cyprus because the winds were contrary. Notice that, underline that. That was the first test. The winds were against them. And when we had sailed over the sea, which is off Cilicia and Pamphylia, we came to Myra, a city of Lycia. There the centurion found an Alexandrian ship sailing to Italy, and he put us all on board. When we had sailed slowly many days and arrived with difficulty off Cnidus, the wind not permitting us to proceed, see, the wind was against them twice, and man, the weather's going to get tough. We sailed under the shelter of Crete off Salmone. Passing it with difficulty, we came to a place called Fair Havens near the city of Lycia. Now, when much time had been spent, sailing was now dangerous because the fast was already over. Paul advised them, saying, men, I perceive that this voyage will end with disaster and much loss, not only of the cargo and ship, but also our lives. Now, he was saying this in his flesh. That's his personal opinion. And he's historically sharing that with us through Dr. Luke, that was his opinion. We shouldn't go. We should probably stay here. He's writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, but he was wrong at that point. He just didn't know it. But watch and see what happened. So he's got in his mindset, if we leave, it's going to be trouble for all of us. Some of us even going to lose our lives. He's thinking that, and he's trying. He's Paul. He's type A. He's driven. He's trying to compel the captain of the ship, don't go, don't go. Can you see the Apostle Paul here? He's fighting his case. He's pleading his case, and he was a wonderful lawyer. Nevertheless, the centurion was more persuaded by the helmsman and the owner of the ship, the one making money, than by the things spoken by Paul. And because the harbor was not suitable to winter in, the majority advised to set sail from there also, if by any means they could reach Phoenix, a harbor of Crete, opening towards the southwest and northwest, and then winter there. When the south wind blew softly, supposing that they had obtained their desire, putting out to sea, they sailed close by Crete, but not long thereafter, a tempestuous headwind arose called Euroclydon. So when the ship was caught and could not head into the wind, we let her drive. And running under the shelter of an island called Clauda, we secured the skiff with difficulty. All through this, he's going to talk about, we had nothing but trouble. When they had taken it on board, they used cables to undergird the ship. Fearing lest they should run aground on the Syrtis sands, they struck sail and so were driven. These are seasoned sailors. They secured the boat by tying rods underneath it, thinking it's going to be broken up. On the third day, we threw the ship's tackle overboard with our own hands. In other words, the things that we would use to catch fish and to get dinner, we started discarding because we were getting worried. Now, when neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and no small tempest beat upon us, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. But after a long absence from food, then Paul stood in the midst of them and said, "Men, you should have listened to me." I'm sure he won lots of friends that day. "You should have listened to me and not have sailed from Crete and incurred this disaster and loss. And now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For there stood by me this night an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve, saying, 'Do not be afraid, Paul, you must be brought before Caesar. And indeed, God has granted you all those who sail with you.'" I'm sure those pagan sailors took stock of that and felt really good. Listen, Paul, by this time, is an older guy. They say he more than likely walked like an old man because he had been beat so many times. He had walked everywhere. He had worked his fingers to the bone as either a tent maker, a dye maker, with leather or some good where he had to provide for it. He was bivocational. He was doing it all. And then every place that he went, first he went to the synagogue when they rejected him, then he'd go to the Gentiles. And many times he was run out of these cities. He was not liked mentally. He was not liked emotionally, psychologically. He had taken a beating. And even those from within the church many times would say, "This guy, Paul, his name, that's just an alias. His real name is Saul of Tarsus. Remember that guy? He was a notorious, you talk about Shemera, you know. This guy, he took my children years ago back to Jerusalem and they torched him." There were stories in the early church about how Saul had done things to early Christians, had stood by and watched Stephen be stoned, holding the coats and urging them on. See, I mean, everything about him, nothing could stop. He just keeps on going. He's the ever-ready Christian bunny. And he's telling them, he's trying to persuade them, "I told you this. You might should have listened, but now, here, take stock in this. My God has told me we're going to lose all of this, but none of us are going to lose our lives." "Now, when the 14th night has come, as we were driven up and down the Adriatic Sea, about midnight, the sailors sensed that they were drawing near some land, and they took soundings and found it to be 20 fathoms. And when they had gone a little further, they took soundings again and found it to be 15 fathoms. Then, fearing lest we should run aground on the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. As the sailors were seeking to escape the ship, when they had let down the skiff into the sea, under pretense of putting out anchors from the prow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, 'Unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved.' The captain went from not listening to Paul at all to wondering if he should listen to Paul at all. Now he's listening to Paul all the time. He has no hope. Paul's given him hope. Then the soldiers cut away the ropes in the skiff and let it fall off. And as day was about to dawn, Paul implored them to all take food, saying, 'Today is the 14th day of you have waited and continued without food and eaten nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is for your survival, since not a hair will fall from the head of any of you.' And when he had said these things, he took bread, gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken, he began to eat." I'm sure he had to show them. And when you're sick from 14 days of going like this, this is how you eat. And once he had done it, they're like, "Okay, your God says it, that's good, but let's see you do it first." And then they did. So, you know, Simon says, and they did. "Then they were all encouraged and also took food themselves. And in all, we were about 276 persons on the ship. There were sailors, seasoned sailors. There was a captain. There were prisoners. And then there's just some paying customers, regular old Joes. So when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship, threw out the wheat into the sea. And when it was day, they did not recognize the land, but they observed a bay with a beach, onto which they planned to run the ship if possible. They let go the anchors and left them in the sea, meanwhile loosing the rudder ropes, and they hoisted the mainsail to the wind and made for shore. But striking a place where two seas met, they ran the ship aground. The prow struck fast and remained immovable, but the stern was being broken up by the violence of the waves. 14 days, this has gone on for many months. Paul's been through it. They've been through it. Don't lose me in all these details, y'all. They have taken it. Have you ever taken it to where you just say, I can't take it anymore? Leon, my dad took me out years ago. I've told you this, deep sea fishing. And by the time I was 3 hours out in the bottom of that boat, and the only time I came up was to say, hey, Lord, watch this. And it was over the side of the ship. And then I would look up to heavens and say, Lord, if you ever get me to dry land again, I swear to you, I promise you, I know I'm not to promise to the Lord, but I swear to you, I'll never come out on another boat deep sea fishing with my father ever again. And I mean, 14 days of this stuff. They're watching the ship get beat up, and men are losing all hope who have been through lots of different storms, and they're listening to a preacher and a lawyer tell them how to navigate the seas. That's how desperate they were. But striking a place where two seas met, they ran the ship aground, and prow stuck fast and remained immovable. Up the stern was broken up by the violence of the waves. As the soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners, lest any of them should swim away and escape, but the centurion, wanting to save Paul, kept them from their purpose and commanded that those who could swim should jump overboard first to get to land, and the rest, some on boards and some on parts of the ship. And so it was, they all escaped safely to land. Wow, what a wonderful chapter. You're saying, why'd you say? He went through a lot of stuff to get through one chapter. Now, chapter 28. Now, when they had escaped, they then found out that the island was called Malta, and the natives showed us unusual kindness, for they kindled a fire and made us all welcome because of the rain that was falling and because of the cold. But when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on a fire, a viper snake came out because of the heat and fastened on his hands. So he's got a snake. I mean, if it's not bad enough that he's lost so much weight from going 14 days without food, and then he's ate and his belly's so full, you know, now he comes to land. There's all 276 have been saved, but they're tired, they're drained. He's fixing a fire in the midst of rain. This is humorous. He bends down into the fire to kindle some sticks. He gets bitten by a snake. What kind of luck does Paul have? If no luck at all. And then Paul did this, so when the natives saw the creature hanging from his hand, they said to one another, no doubt this man is a murderer whom, though he's escaped the sea, yet justice does not allow to live. So they're looking at him and saying, he's a murderer, and his God is striking him. But he shook off the creature into the fire and suffered no harm. However, they were expecting that he would swell up or suddenly fall down dead. But after they had looked for a long time and saw no harm come to him, they changed their minds and said that he was good, or that he was a god. Can you imagine this scene? They're all watching Paul. It's just funny. It gets funnier. But there's a reason why God is allowing all these sailors, all these prisoners, every single one of them, are going through the same thing with the Apostle Paul, and something wonderful is going to happen. Now they get on shore, and they have attracted a lot. I mean, they're different color. They speak a different dialect. These people are all gathered around. Paul reaches into the fire. How does Paul stand out to the people on the island of Malta? Well, God's going to have it. A snake bites him. So instead of swelling up or dying, he shakes the thing off. No big deal. And they're now paying great attention to the same guy on the ship who was the loudmouth, saying, you should have listened to me from the day that we set sail. In that region, there was an estate of the leading citizen on the island, whose name was Publius, who received us and entertained us courteously for 3 days. And it happened that the father of Publius lay sick of a fever and dysentery. Paul went in to him and prayed and laid his hands on him, and what? Healed him. Underline that word, healed. And when this was done, the rest of those on the island who had diseases also came and were healed. Now, they were honoring us in many ways, and when we departed, they provided such things as were necessary. God provided for Paul, for the sailors, and all the prisoners, while he led many, all of them on board, had the attention that they so wanted of God through Paul. And Paul's traveling with two other guys that I've mentioned, at least on his team. One's name is Luke, who is writing this account for us, who just by chance happens to be a doctor. Now, here's what's crazy, and I'll be done in just 2 minutes. In verse 8, the word healed in the Greek language is aomai, and it means miraculously, immediately, supernaturally healed. Paul laid hands on this man and prayed, and this older fella immediately was healed, which meant everyone on that island, a deserted place that just didn't see many guests and visitors, they all came out to the show. And they came to see Paul and to hear him, and you can only gather from that they would have heard his message. They would have listened to him. Why? Because the man who controlled the island, his father was dying, and Paul healed him. And Paul was the guy who just had been bitten by a snake and shook it off like nothing. The people are thinking he's a god. And by the time Paul's done saying, no, I'm not a god, but I know him and I can introduce you to him. And I want to introduce you to his healing power. So now, here's the crazy thing about this text. The second word there in verse 9 says, and they who came to Paul, they were all healed. But the word healed there is not the same word in Greek. Why would the writers mess us up there and use a different word? Because it wasn't the same kind of healing. There are those in our day who still believe that God and God alone heals, and that you can't go and shouldn't go to a doctor or a nurse or to medicine. So they don't allow their children to be treated medicinally. They don't go to a therapist or to a doctor or to a nurse or to a doctor's aide. They won't go because it's against their faith, because they don't believe that God can heal. And the word here is therapeuo, which we get our English word therapeutic. So in other words, Paul was the main show. And when he healed this man, the whole island came. He's got the attention of the sailors. He's got the attention of the sickened. He's got the attention of the prisoners. Everyone is paying attention. How could they not? They had gone through so much. They had been so sick. They had been so desperate. They got to a point that Paul's healing was just the last thing that would show them the touch of Jesus. And then Dr. Luke, the traveling companion of Paul, treated therapeutically those on that island, and they were all healed. Isn't that something? Now, last thing I'll say, go back to Isaiah 53, verse 5. Just write this in the margins of your Bible. The word there in Hebrew is sozo, for healing. By his stripes we are healed. Sozo means physically, medically, emotionally, mentally, psychologically, but most importantly, salvifically. You are healed. Now let me tell you, disease and cancer and sickness and not having an appetite that you can even eat or hold anything down, all these things, rheumatoid, all of these things, all of these afflictions that we have, I am healed. I know that my Redeemer lives. And I know that my Redeemer has saved me and that my Redeemer has healed me. I am healed. When he takes me to the inn and says, I am coming again and I will pay back that which I know when I'm wounded, stranded, left on the roadside, and no one else cares, I know my Savior sees me. He is the Good Samaritan. He sends people my way who lets me know that God has sent them as a messenger, not to buffet me, but to bring me closer to Him. And I have been healed. I've got to believe, and by faith to believe and count that my faith has healed me in the one who has covered me for my sins. By His stripes we are healed, and according to Peter, we were healed. Are you acting like a healed person? Are you under the affliction of that which is taking you down? You've got to get in your mindset, one last thing and I'm done. You've got to be like the Apostle Paul and just say, no matter what, I have learned in this state to be content. I'm going to get the job done. I'm going to do what God called me to do. Whether I do it crawling, limping, bent over backward, it doesn't matter. If you have taken Jesus Christ as your own, physical death leads to spiritual everlasting life. You will live forever. This is how I say it. You are a winner. You will never be a loser ever again once you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, because He has not only given you hope, He has not only given you help or the helper, He has healed you once and for all. If I'm going around with a physical affliction and I know in a week, in a month, in 10 years, I'm going to be healed, let me tell you, that makes me live a little bit different. That makes me think a little bit different, because I know physical death, physical life, may be snuffed out, but that leads to life like I've never lived life before. And Jesus said, I have come to give them life, and life more abundant. Lord Jesus, may